Hello everyone. Now this is the part 3 of NEET MDS 2021 question paper series. So before starting this video, again I want to say that these are just remembered questions. So the questions or option, even the answers may vary. Now let's start the video. So first question was about the snake bite. So they have just asked about the symptoms of snake bite, in which they have given a figure of ptosis, and so ptosis, bilateral ptosis and ophthalmoplegia are the two of the most common ocular manifestation resulting from systemic toxicity of neurotoxic snake bites. The other general symptoms include dizziness, fainting, rapid pulse, low BP, severe shock, bleeding, discoloration, burning sensation, loss of coordination, weakness, numbness, tingling, bleeding spot, diarrhea, etc. So in the examination, they have given the diagram of ptosis. So the option was ptosis. I hope it's clear. Now moving to the next question. The next question was about the palato-gingival groove. So palato-gingival groove is also referred to as a palato-radicular groove, distolingual groove, coronoradicular groove, or radicular lingual groove. So it exists on the palatal aspect of lateral incisor and run towards the mesial, distal, and mid-palatal root regions. So the etiologies are infolding of enamel organs, and HER is stimulating a mild form of dense invaginatus. The second is an aborted attempt towards the formation of additional root on affected tooth. And recently, there is an alteration of genetic mechanism and racial link has been proposed. So in the question paper, they have asked about the palato-gingival groove. I hope it's clear. Now moving to the next question. So the next question was adenomatoid odontogenic tumor. So AOT represents about 3 to 7% of all odontogenic tumors. AOT is also called as two-third tumor. So it is called two-third because two-third of the cases occurs in the age group of 10 to 19 years. Two-third cases are seen in females and two-third in the anterior jaws. Even the two-third cases are seen in maxilla. Hence, it is also called as two-third tumor. I hope it's clear. Now, moving to the next question. The next question was about the smart burst. And it was again an image-based question. So, smart burst is a plastic burr which is made up of polyamide or imide polymer possessing slightly lower mechanical properties than the sound dentine. So they are hard enough to remove decayed dentine, but they stop when it reaches the hard and healthy dentine. So I hope it's clear. Now moving to the next question. So the next question was about the Bell's palsy. So they have given an image in which the signs and symptoms of Bell palsy was given. So Bell palsy is a form of facial paralysis resulting from a dysfunction of cranial nerve 7, that is the facial nerve, that results in the inability to control the facial muscles on the affected side. So the symptoms include only on the symptoms are visible only on the one side of the face, and it may range from mild to severe. The other symptoms are difficulty in closing one eye, or dry eye, drooling, drooping, difficulty in eating and drinking, twitching, or weakness of the muscles of face. I hope it's clear. Now moving to the next question. The next question was about the diagnosis of diabetes. So the diabetes test, HbA1c, it measures the average level of blood sugar over the past 2 to 3 months, and it is also called as HbA1c glycated hemoglobin test or glycohemoglobin. So the normal ranges are in percentage, the normal range of HbA1c is less than 5.7%. In pre-diabetics, it is 5.7 to 6.5%, and in diabetic patients, it is more than 6.5%. So I hope it's clear. Now moving to the next question. In next question, they have asked about the immunoglobulin which is present in the saliva. So the answer was IgA. So let's discuss about the immunoglobulin. So IgG is the most abundant type of antibody found in all body fluids and protect against the bacterial and viral infections. IgA is found in high concentration in the mucous membranes, particularly those lining the respiratory passages and GIT tract, as well as in saliva and tears. IgM is mainly found in the blood and lymph fluid, and it is the first antibody that is to be made by the body to fight a new infection. So IgM generally represents the acute infection. IgE is associated with allergic reaction, and it is found in lungs, skin, and mucous membrane. Now IgD, it exists in small amount in the blood, and it is the least understood antibody in the body. Now moving to the next question. So the next question was about the drug of choice for necrotizing ulcerative gingivitis. So the option, the correct option was metronidazole. So local measures like scaling, irrigation, oral hygiene maintenance are the local measures to be taken for NUGS. And as an adjunct to local measures, metronidazole is the drug of choice. So mode of action of metronidazole are by inhibiting DNA synthesis, and the doses of the metronidazole are in 1 to 3 years of patient, it is 50 milligram suspension TDS. In 3 to 7 years, it is 100 milligram suspension BD. In 7 to 10 years, it is 100 milligram suspension TDS. In 10 to 18 years, it is 200 to 250 milligram TDS. And in adults, it is generally 400 milligram TDS. So now moving to the next question. So the next question was about the bifid rib syndrome. So bifid rib syndrome is also called as Gorlin-Gall syndrome. So the clinical features are, it consists of multiple odontogenic keratocyst, bifid rim, and basal cell carcinoma, and other abnormalities. So in the question paper, they have asked about the bifid rib syndrome. I hope it's clear. Now moving to the next question. So the next question was the repeated question. This question came in the NEET MDS 2020, and the question, even the options were exact same. So the question was, titanium welding is done by using which technique? The options were plasma arc welding, laser welding, vacuum welding, and spot welding. So the correct answer was laser welding. Now moving to the next question. So the next question was about the buccinator mechanism. So buccinator mechanism, the muscles involved in buccinator mechanism are buccinator orbicularis oris, superior constrictor muscles, and pterygomandibular rapid. So this mechanism is essential for the orofacial functions like swallowing, sucking, whistling, chewing, vowel pronunciation. So if buccinator is weakened or paralyzed, then food tend to accumulate in the vestibule during the chewing. So in the examination, they have asked which muscle. So it is superior constrictor muscle. So thank you. That's all for today's video. If you have any query, let me know in the comment section. And if you find this video informative, then please press thumbs up. Till then, take care and happy learning. Thank you.